So the title of the presentation is New Methods for Morphing Wing Aerostructural Performances Improvement. And okay, so the summary is of the presentation is divided into the presentations of the project context, the skin shape optimization for the morphing wing, the experimental setup description, the testing results, and the conclusions. So I would like to say that in this CREAC MDO-505 project, the one that I'm presenting today on the morphing architectures and related technologies for wingtip efficiency improvement, the aim of this project is actually to reduce the operating costs for the new generation of aircraft through fuel economy to improve their performances. Actually, we are talking about the green aircraft technology. This CREAC MDO-505 project is a continuation of a previous CREAC 7.1 project, and its partners are international partners from Canada, where I am, and Italy. So the project was realized in collaboration with Thales and Bombardier in Canada, also with NRC Research Institute, and with another university, Ecole Polytechnique in Montreal, and was funded in Canada by CREAC and NSERC. Also, the Italian partners were people from University Napoli Federico II, Alenia and CIRA. The objective of the project was to develop a system for active control of a morphing wingtip during flight in order to keep most of laminar flow over the upper surface of the wing. Actually, the final aim was to develop a controller which was relating the pressure sensors to the electrical actuators from the CFD database initially built, in order to have the less transition, the less turbulence possible. So we had to move the transition region actually towards the trailing edge of the airfoil. At the LARCAS laboratory, which I'm leading, and actually I was also the leader of this very huge project, the main role of the LARCAS team was to design, develop, integrate, and validate a control system for the transition control of the morphing wing, which was equipped with electrical actuators and pressure sensors. The control system has been validated by bench testing at ETS, so in our university, in the absence of aerodynamics, and after that in wind tunnels, therefore through wind tunnel testing at NRC in Ottawa. The paper presents the design and the experimental wind tunnel testing of the morphing wingtip model. In the next slides, we present the architecture of the control morphing wing system, the skin shape optimization, the bench test, and the wind tunnel test experimental setup, the graphical user interface, and the experimental results obtained for control system and aerodynamics. The wing model was based actually on the dimensions of a full-scale wingtip structure from Bombardier Aerospace Company in Montreal. And for this reason, as you see below here in on the bottom left, the span and the chord of the model matched also the dimensions of a real aircraft wingtip. Therefore, 1.5 meter span and 1.5 meter root chord with a taper ratio of 0.72. It's important to mention that the wingtip actually was formed by the wing and by the aileron, but we didn't have a winglet as shown in this bottom figure left, and it was close to the fuel tank. On the real aircraft. Therefore, in the wind tunnel and actually in our project, we considered only the wing and the aileron once again. That's what we called wingtip. You can see on the right-hand side also the inner structure of the wingtip. Actually of the wing really, the four actuators, the ribs, the spars and the lower skin that we were supposed and we designed and actually we installed over. And another design, actually, you could see on the upper right hand side, where you see the actuators and the flexible aileron or the morphing aileron. So high grade industry steel and aluminum alloy materials were used for the manufacturing of different internal structure elements. The adaptive upper surface was made in carbon fiber composite materials and was positioned between 20% and 65% of the wing chord. And it was specifically designed and therefore optimized to meet aeronautical industry requirements. Therefore, we are talking about an aerostructural optimization. And we could see here further the drawings of the airfoil leading edge, the wing aileron, the trailing edge, and the four actuators again. You can see for the actuators that we had actuators one and two at one spanwise direction and actuators three and four on another spanwise direction, while the actuators one and three were at the same chordwise position and actuators two and four at another chordwise position. We could see also the stringers and the ribs and also the airfoil, which is a 2D CAD of the wing, of course. So we could see also that the experimental wing model, we have to say, contains three main parts. A metal part, which was coming from the original aircraft wing and had an unmodified structure, which was able to sustain the wing loads. Then there was a morphing part, which consisted of a flexible skin installed on the upper surface of the wing, and an actuated aileron, which was designed starting from the original one on the aircraft. Once again, all this structure was based on the structure and on the aerodynamic data from the Bombardier Aircraft Company. The morphing part, or rather the flexible skin situated on the upper surface of the wing, was actuated by four similar electrical actuators, which was placed on two actuation lines. Actuator one and actuator three were situated at 32% of the chord, while actuators two and four were situated at 48% of the chord. For the skin shape optimization, we had to optimize it from aerodynamics and then from structural point of view. Therefore, for its optimization from aerodynamic point of view, we had to use an in-house developed genetic algorithm, which was applied to the solve the problem of an airfoil upper surface morphing in 2D. So the objective was to search and therefore to find the optimal shapes of an airfoil through local thickness modifications with the aim to improve the upper surface flow and therefore the aerodynamic performances of the airfoil. Therefore, for different flight conditions and airfoil coordinates, we had to couple actually for the optimization process the X-foil results with the genetic algorithm that we had to build. The optimization process was therefore an iterative one, which needed several interactions between genetic algorithm parameters, objective function, aerodynamic solver, and shape reconstruction using spline interpolation. The aerodynamic analysis was done by using the X-foil aerodynamic solver, as already said, which would allow both inviscid and viscous calculation. However, I would like to point out that the calculations done in X-foil in 2D were also validated with calculations done in 3D in ANSYS Fluent, therefore for the entire wing. So due to time, of course, we had to validate the most important cases and we obtained very good results for 2D and 3D calculations. In addition, I have to underline the fact that, of course, the actuators were moving upwards and downwards. They were moving the flexible skin. And their displacements were determined from the genetic optimization of the wing airfoil already mentioned before. And this one was considered and applied for several conditions of Mach number, angles of attack, and aileron deflection angles. Therefore, here you have a Monte Carlo map, which shows optimization results for one flow case. So of course, we had to repeat the processes for all the flow cases. And the optimization gave the displacement values, for example, for one pair of actuators situated at the 37% of the wing, while the displacement for the second pair of actuators, as mentioned on the previous slide, were calculated as linear dependence. The objective function was constructed based on the desired objective of influencing the upper surface flow of the wing with the purpose of minimizing drag and delaying the flow transition from laminar to turbulent flow for a more stable boundary layer. On this slide, you could see actually the actuator displacements versus the aileron deflection angle and versus the angle of attack. Therefore, on the upper drawings, we can see the actuators 1 and 2 displacements for Mach 0.15 from left to the right. And on the right, the actuators 3 and 4 displacements for Mach 0.15 always. On the down side of the figure, we could see the displacements for Mach 0.25. So the 4 actuators, once again, said already, well, they gave displacements up and down of the flexible skin, and they have a nonlinear behavior of the 4 points of the flexible skin to become an optimized airfoil shape. During the first set of wind tunnel tests, we had to test 97 flight cases for 19 values of angles of attack, 3 for Mach numbers, and 13 for aileron deflection angles. The angles of attack varied from -3 to 3 degrees. The Mach number varied from 0.15 to 0.25, and the aileron deflection angles varied between -6 and 6 degrees. The 97 desired optimized efforts were obtained by changing the upper surface of the wing in the vertical direction. The aerodynamic goal was to extend, once again, the laminar region by moving the transition region as near as possible to the wing trailing edge with a constant lift. We could see on this assay the fact that we had to develop the actuator prototype at ETS, and we were not able to get the forces versus the displacements for actuators on the market. Therefore, we developed in-house, and you can see the design and manufacturing of one version. And finally, the last version was this one on the bottom right. And we had also to do its bench testing on the upper right-hand side where you see the how we did its testing. Regarding now the sensor installation, as you have seen the actuators, and we know that we had to use a controller in order to relate and connect the actuators to the sensors, right? So for the sensors installation, we use two types of sensors. So we use 32 high precision Coolite piezoelectric type sensors in order to evaluate the laminar to turbulent transition location. Actually, the same type of sensor that we use in a previous CRIAC 7.1 project. And these sensors were installed in two staggered lines with 16 Coolite sensors on each line, and they were situated at 0.6 and 0.625 meters from the wing root section. And you can see it on the left downside, you know, you can see here in black the composite flexible skin, which was changing with the actuators, and on which you can see this band at 0.6 meters and 0.625 meters where the Coolite sensors were installed. At the same two spanwise station, 60 static pressure taps were installed, and you can see it on the bottom right-hand side. And we had 30 taps on each line on the wing leading edge, lower surface and aileron, and Therefore, we obtained an experimental pressure distribution around the wing cross section at 40% of the wingspan. We also had to do static 1G tests to see if the structure of the wing would resist to 1G loads. And under this load, the actuators should have been always able to change the wing shape as expected, right, to get the optimized shape. The experimental loading generated internal efforts, so Fy, Mx, Mz equal or higher to those generated by the design loads of 1G without exceeding those generated by loads of 2.5G. High precision photogrammetry was also used to measure the flexible skin. And we had circular retroreflective markers applied on the upper surface, as you see on this drawing down in the middle. And you can see down on your left-hand side, the wing for its static bench test. It was very important, of course, to see if any deformations unexpected occurred after each bench test or wind tunnel test. So that's why it was very important also to scan the flexible skin. Then we had to manufacture, right? So there were many people involved in the manufacturing, not only in the design part. So you could see the leading, the morphing skin, more in details here, how they were built, I mean, manufactured, how they look like. Then we had to do an experimental setup. Therefore, you can see here the system interfacing the remote computer and the morphing wing experimental model that was designed by using a National Instruments real-time target on your right-hand side. And then we also have a remote computer with which we were supposed to control the aileron and the wing together. And we had also a feedback considered for the control system of the morphing actuators provided by four LVDTs used as position sensors and having axis parallel to actuators axis. You can see the experimental instrumentation from National Instruments in our paper, so I'm not going to go in details on it. And you can see the hardware on this slide. So you could see once again the wing, the computer, the National Instruments hardware, Maxon motor drives, power supplies, and the inner of the wing. On this slide, we could see the connections and actually the signal and data acquisition of the LVDTs, Coolite CAN actuators, the data exchange, Maxon drive supplies. So again, we'll not go into the details of this experimental setup, would take too much time. What is important to say is that control was, of course, always done in real time in the wind tunnel, during the wind tunnel test. And you can see here the example of the graphical user interface in the CREAC MDO-707 project. Therefore, for a certain Mach number, angle of attack, and aileron deflection angles, we could see the desired versus the experimental control displacements of the actuators in all these four windows. Therefore, for each flight case, we had to observe where the displacements would match. And then if everything was okay, we would move to the next slide, to the next flight case. It's important also to say that in the wind tunnel, we had to install a pressure wake rake for drag measurements at the Coolite positions that you can see it on the left-hand side. And we also did infrared measurements, actually it's NRC, which was in charge with them. And for the large induced aerodynamic loads, the wind tunnel balance was grounded. And you can see on the right-hand side, the equipment for the infrared. And on this slide, you can see another type of real-time data acquisition on the computer that we did in the previous CREAC 7.1 project. And you can see it really in real time. Therefore, on your left-hand side, you could see the displacements, real versus optimized, and how everything was moving, the PSD data, and where we would look for transition, for so forth. And here you can see also we used a lot of MATLAB software, so you could see the results in MATLAB of the deflections of the actuators required versus the real ones. So on the left-hand side, you can see the bench test for a flow case. And on the right-hand side, the bench test is asked for repeated step signals. We could also see the laser scanning of the morphing wing during bench tests that I mentioned also before when we looked at the static 1G test. And we had two ways of validation our methodology. So the first method was calculate the power spectra densities and standard deviations. And therefore, on the left-hand side, you could see these four figures, which represent the power spectra densities for the 32 Coulide sensors. So each figure shows eight type of results of power spectra for sensors 1 to 8, for example, the upper left-hand side. And these PSDs showed actually that the transition was between channels 15 and 19, while when we did a standard deviation, which we can see on its right hand side, the standard deviation of pressure data showed that the pressure sensor 19 gave the highest value, which this is the peak, which means that actually the transition for this specific flight case took place at the sensor 19. The second testing results we should give actually the same results as the first model, the first methodology with Coulide sensors, looking at transition using controls, was of course done with infrared camera, which I already mentioned before. Therefore, on this slide, you could see the results for one flight case. So we could see the transition has been delayed by 4% of the chord, therefore from 48% to 52% of the chord. So on the right-hand side, we could see really the delay. And we could also see the rows of the sensors in white and the four actuators, we could also see them. So it's important to say that the wing leading edge, its upper surface, flexible skin, and the aileron interface were coated with high emissivity black paint in order to improve the quality of the infrared photographs. So the spanwise stations where the two pressure sensors lines were installed were not painted in order to influence the pressure reading quality. So you could see it, they were in white. And the Genoptic Variocam camera with a resolution of 640 multiplied by 480 pixels was used to measure the surface temperatures. This camera was equipped with 60 degrees lens in order to capture the flow transition on the entire upper surface of the wing. In conclusion, we could show, we have shown the development and experimental wind tunnel testing of a new multidisciplinary morphing wing model. The validation of the transition region was done using two methods, the Coulide pressure sensor controller and the infrared measurements at NRC. During the first set of wind tunnel tests, 97 flight cases were tested, 19 angles of attack, 3 values for Mach numbers, and 13 values for the aileron deflection angles. The angles of attack varied from -3 to 3 degrees, Mach numbers between 0.15 and 0.25, and the aileron deflection angles varied between -6 to 6 degrees. The 97 desired optimized efforts were obtained by changing the upper surface of the wing in the vertical direction. We did 3 sets of wind tunnel tests. The third set took place on morphing wing and morphing aileron in collaboration with the Italian team. And the experimentally obtained results confirmed the feasibility of the morphing wing technology. And having in mind that our project used a real wing structure from Bombardier, this created premises for a future application of this technology on real aircraft. We have at our laboratory these equipments which help us in our research. So we have a flight simulator level D on Cessna Citation X business aircraft. We recently acquired another one for CRJ 700. And we have a UAS S4 from Hydra Technology, as well as a wind tunnel test called Price by Ducis from Megia. Thank you very much.